I know you have a knack for languages. You speak Portuguese and Spanish. Are you fluent in both those languages?
I am, yes. I mean, I can't take too much credit, right? I mean, if you live in Spain for 6 years and you don't learn Spanish, it's on you. It's on you.
Absolutely.
And then I was born in Brazil. And I do enjoy language. I think languages and food, and you know, this is the most primal way to connect with people.
Definitely.
And you know, I've had a very kind of international background. And when people ask me, like, what's the, and I say, you know, you can be friendly, you can learn certain gestures, but until you're willing to speak to them colloquially in their language and eat their food, because food has such deep-rooted cultural meaning, right? Like, it ties to history.
Definitely.
And it triggers certain emotions that nothing else does. I think it creates a certain bond, and it's my wife has a very sensitive stomach, and I have a pretty, you know, I can eat anything that doesn't talk back to me, and it's quite a skill. I enjoy it. But it's been such a useful thing to bond with people. I've had global roles, international roles. I've worked in different markets, and just my ability and interest in connecting with people.
Yeah.
Over even if it's just a few words and their food. Fascinating.
Yeah, it's interesting what you're saying, because what I'm hearing is someone who's very international but still very, very sure of their roots, very, very much a Syrian abroad. We've had a lot of guests recently who have really been questioning a lot where they're from. You know, what does it mean to be from somewhere when you've lived in so many different places around the world? And like you, I'm Egyptian, but I spent all my life in different countries. So, but again, the Egyptian is still very much there. So it's interesting that you have that foundation is still very strong in you. Your wife?
It's a defense mechanism.
That's interesting. Yeah,
absolutely. I think if you don't recognize and own who you are, then you're exposed to people telling you who you are. And that's a very dangerous thing.
That's right. I also think that comes from someone who's very confident in themselves and very sure of themselves. And that's a very good thing, because you're not going to be told you are this and you are that. You already know, which is good. Is your wife also Syrian, Fedez?
My wife is Jordanian. Wife is Jordanian. We met in Dubai. My wife is Christian. I'm Muslim, so it's also kind of adds a twist to the whole thing. And to me, you know, both of us, I think, we represent the diversity of the region in many ways, and it's I think it makes our household a lot richer.
Let's move on, Fedez, and look at. So you stayed with Booz in the region. Were you based out of Dubai with them?
I was based out of Dubai, but my first 3-4 years, I would spend like 6 nights a month in Dubai. I mean, I worked in Saudi, Nigeria, India, all over.
Were you focused on the tech industry at the time in the region, or were you going across the board? You were mainly media, right? You were.
I was still CMT, a similar practice, but given the dynamics of the region, I was mostly doing a lot of telco work. They were the bigger clients, and also a lot of public sector work, a lot of government. There was a lot of governments that were going through digitization, and so there was a lot of this type of work. And then the one thing, though, about consulting was the lifestyle. You know, up to that point, I was single. You know, it's quite taxing, extensive travel, long hours. And at one point, I wanted to have a little stability. Like, I, you know, apartment barely furnished, no car, just kind of very, very light. And I wanted to lay some roots. And so I decided to shift, and I got an opportunity to go back into media, which was with NBC Group. NBC was obviously largest media group in the region. I had some friends there, and they were looking to they recognized that they had a very huge presence on TV, on in traditional media, but the chairman recognized that there is a pivot towards digital, and that was going to come quickly, and so he wanted to build a little bit more the digital arm. And so I came to basically be head of digital business development, which later on included, you know, Shahid, investments in Anghami, and a bunch of other stuff. It mm-hmm. sounded like a really interesting opportunity because it's you know, I didn't know that everything I had been doing would lead to this intersection, which is media and telecom. Until that point, they kind of operated in parallel lanes, but mm-hmm. With the rise of OTT, over-the-top applications and video on demand, this intersection, they started converging. And so that was a perfect intersection for me where I could combine media and tech. And the opportunity came to do that. Before joining, though, a bunch of us at Booz, we launched another startup, which was, so it was four guys launching a cosmetics online company, which we grew and then later on went to sell.
Was that a sideline for you, Fedis? Were you in a main job at the time, or was this? Did you kind of leave that and do this full time? Or
so I did. We took turns in a way. I had a gap between the jobs and started me and another guy were kind of like quite hands on in kicking it off, and then one other partner of mine. Took on kind of being CEO for a while, but we were all quite involved over a period of like 4 to 5 years.
Right.
And we raised funding. Actually, NBC ended up being an investor. Saudi Telecom was an investor. Al Bilad Bank in Saudi, and then a consortium in Saudi ended up buying it out.
You know, when as you're talking, I'm noticing that it's the startups that make you smile. And it's the startups that you start with your friends, or when your friends are involved, that you have a twinkle in your eye about the self, you know, the self-created businesses. You know.
It's well, I have a soft spot in my heart for startup because you're creating something, right? And you are at the end kind of master of the destiny of this company. Of the people that work at this company, you create a brand, and it goes back to the theme that you create something that is bigger than you. It still warms my heart till today when I meet, you know, usually ladies, and then they say, "Oh, I used to subscribe to Glambox, or I used to buy stuff from you guys." It's a nice feeling because you know, it's something that you know started
that had an impact
around the dining room table. As you know, a couple of friends starting, and then you know it goes on to become something bigger. And even my involvement today, like I sit on the board of Kafu in the UAE, which is a fueling app, and a couple of other startup, Enhance and Kidzonet, and a few other. And just watching the story evolve, you know, I'm obviously less involved, but watching the story and the trials and tribulations of the entrepreneurs and the teams. You know, they pour their hearts and souls into it, and that level of commitment is invigorating. It moves you emotionally, and I always tell them whether it succeeds or fails, it will be a pivotal point in your lives because it's something that is an extension of you. Few roles or jobs end up being an extension of you. But when you start a company, it's always an extension of you.
I'd like to look into a little bit about the emerging social trends that you're seeing globally, but specifically in the region. Do they differ? Are the global trends different to the local trends? What do you see happening currently and in, let's say, the next 5 years or so?
So, look, I think the global trends tend to align to some degree. I think the uptake from the region is where we see slight differences. You know, unfortunately, right now we don't see a lot of technology innovation coming out of the region. in terms of like, we're not seeing massive, you know, AI development here or VR, AR, et cetera, hardware. But what we do see is that once some of these trends emerge, we see massive uptake from the region. Mm-hmm. And I think that ties
we're
to...
We're very much early adopters, aren't we, in the region of technology,
yes,
right?
Early and heavy adopters. You know, the region is 70% under 30, in most part 200% mobile penetration. And we just have this hunger to try things. So it's very common that within our platforms or even other platforms that somebody will reach out and say, look, I'm a startup in San Francisco and we just launched this thing, and all of a sudden we see like a massive spike out of the region. We're not even marketing in the region. And you see that a lot for a couple of youth, mobile adaptivity. We're massive consumers of content. So anything content, like I said, you know, twice the global average of content consumption. We see a huge concentration. We have about 5.5 million creators that like self-identify creators here, more than any other part in EMEA, almost as many as the US. We see huge upload of content. We see innovation, also a lot of creativity around content and creators and what people do. So in that sense, it's about how can we manage that and keep up with those kind of innovations. Some of it is on us to bespoke certain things, like provide the right to left text for people to be able to communicate in Arabic, provide the right kind of stickers and tools. And other is also to come up, you know, kind of listen to the region. That's part of our role, and feedback that to our engineers to for them to create some of the functionality that the region is demanding, which I think can unlock massive potential here.
Mm-hmm. And is part of the emerging trends looking at the metaverse? Is that? Do you think that that's going to impact our region as fast as it is in other areas of the world, or are we going to be lagging behind in that a little bit? And firstly, actually, maybe you could explain the metaverse to us and to me, because I've had a few people on the show explain it, but it's always. It's an important subject, and we need to just start to get our head around the whole concept. So if you wouldn't mind giving us a sort of an elementary explanation.
Sure. So look, I think part of the reason it's vague and maybe a bit confusing is that it's still shaping up, right? I mean, there are some principles, which is that rather than interacting with the internet from the outside as a two-dimensional internet, the idea is to blend that internet into our reality.
Mm-hmm.
So today, I'm gonna get on the internet. You know, I'm gonna pick up my phone and get on the internet. But what if that internet was interweaved into our world? If this conversation was happening with me being an avatar next to you, or you being an avatar next, or both of us being in a virtual space where we're able to interact, that makes a richer experience. If we're both sitting there and you're asking me to explain the metaverse, and I can create a world and demonstrate that to you, I can put you on a beach or in a mountain or in having my dinner with characters. I can have Nelson Mandela and Mother Teresa and Obama around the table and have that conversation. Around my dining room table. So the mix of virtual and actual reality, I think the ramifications of those principles are massive. I can, you know, you have a knee injury.
Are.
I can look at I can look at your knee and be able to see the actual injury. And potentially from a remote location, be able to conduct a surgery. Or if you're having a mechanical issue with a very, complex machinery, and somebody from Germany is able to dial in and do that. If I am case in point about innovation in the region and the metaverse, a doctor in Lebanon who anesthesiologist that noticed that young kids, under 6 years old, like undergoing anesthesia, were going, you know, they have a high level of anxiety. The sensation of anesthesia gives them, you know, anxiety because they feel they're losing control of their body. She started using the Quest devices to put them in a kind of cartoon like world so that it eases them in and out of anesthesia. Like everything on our platform, it's for us to build the pillars, and then we rely on the ecosystem for implications and use cases. Now, in order for that to happen, we've always said it's going to be a 5 to 10 year horizon. And I think there was so much excitement early on that people were getting frustrated that there's not, you know, where is it? When is the launch? And, you know, I think saying to people it's 10 years out is a bit frustrating. But I think once these innovations start to happen, just like with the mobile phone or the internet in the 90s, as we were talking about that, once it starts happening, it happens fairly quickly. But until then, we recognize that these devices need to be smaller. They need to be cheaper to ensure that everybody has accessibility. We recognize that it's not just about living in a virtual world, but it needs to bring the real world and the virtual world together to make a richer experience. And that will take time. It will happen, but it will take time. And you know, the externality that need to take place around it as well.
And how do you, I mean, I'm sure a company such as Facebook, such as Meta, look forward and try and look at the potential pitfalls or problems that could be associated with the metaverse. What do you see as the warning signs that might appear in the future? What are those things that you're concerned about, that you're thinking how to solve now?
So, look, some of the things we can predict, like I think copyright issues, you know, when you're looking at virtual assets, kind of IP rights and trademarks, the safety and security and, you know, personal space. Like one thing that very quickly became apparent is that we need to provide people the ability to create a personal bubble, right, in order to give them a space. But I think learning from our challenges in the past is that, A, it's not realistic that we'll be able to predict all the challenges. And so we've allocated a fund $50 million a year to basically for academic institutions, think tanks, civil rights societies to think through some of these challenges and what might come up and feed them into us. We also learned that because regulators don't move as quickly, it's like we need to make sure we're walking regulators with us through this journey, because we don't want to be the arbiters of this truth or the regulators of this society. I mean, there are very smart people that think about kind of society and the way we move forward. And the definition of society is an agreed set of rules that we all agree to operate under, right? And that's why societies differ from place to place. And so as we go into this new frontier, I think it's important for us to jointly agree on what that would look like. And that's why maybe a 5 to 10 year horizon is not a bad thing. To give us time to gradually move into that space.